This is Xenia Durgos. She's coming from the University of Zagreb. And she will talk about the risk assessment, more or less, of chemical substances in water. So we have a problem nowadays, which is the water contamination. And the idea is that we'd like to know if this water is safe or not for drink consumption and everything. And she will give a new approach in which you can use biological systems for a better evaluation of the chemical substances. You will hear the talk about this topic briefly. She has been involved in several articles and projects and so on. Her research is related with the risk assessment of chemical substances. She had some evaluation about the effects assessment of chemicals, also with a focus with the risk characterization and so on. And the chemicals that she has been doing some research have been on several families. I mean, you can have some persistent organic pollutants, also some natural compounds which can be found naturally in the environment, and for which you can have several uses. Even we have some pharmacy students here also, so some of the extracts from the plants can be used as several treatments. So with those of many chemicals, I mean, in several research that articles she had, she was using different biological systems to check what was the toxicity or the effects of those chemical substances. So she has a very nice experience in this. So we had the opportunity to invite Xenia Durgo for under the frame of the master and doctoral studies, for which we think in general that it could be very good for your training and experience and everything. So, please, Xenia, this is now for you. And
thank you.
And we hear you with most interest.
Okay, but thank you, Javier. Okay, first of all, I would like to thank you for coming here today. And also, I would like to thank to Professor Javier and the people who run this university for giving me opportunity to come and to talk to you today. Okay. So, as Javier said, today I would like to talk to you about safety, groundwater safety. What is the importance of the groundwater? Where do we use groundwaters? Majority of groundwaters are served for drinking purposes. Okay, in majority of the countries, water that is filtered through the different rocks or soils and so on, in some way ends up in wells, and those wells are actually a source of water that we will maybe bottle and drink, or we will have our own wells from which we will take that water. So the importance of safety of the water that we are drinking is very huge, and there are several problems that we can connect with that groundwater safety. And during this lecture, we will try to point out what problems are and how can we maybe find a way how to resolve those problems. At the end of the lecture, I will show you two examples. One example of investigation of water that comes from the heavy metal industry, and the other sample, I will show you an example of experiments that we have run with the waters that were collected at the site of the landfill and around the landfill. So we will see how we can combine actually chemical, physical, and results of physical, chemical, and biological analysis. Okay, so now let's make a little introduction in this story. I think that we are all aware that we live in quite organized world where quite a lot of things are able for us. If we are thirsty, we will just go and buy a bottle of water. We don't have to search it somewhere in the environment. We all have quite high requests for the quality of life. We like to live cozy life, we like to have enough food, we like to have air-conditioned environment where we live, we like to heat our room where we live during the winter time. So we have really high requests when we talk about standard of life. And that request is rising and rising with the time, with the year. If you compare people who were living in the caves, and if you compare modern men, you will see that we really are increasing our life standards. But what is the price? What price do we pay? We have to obtain material that will ensure us that cozy, nice life. So that means that we have to exploitate more and more raw materials. It means that we have to produce more and more things. And in one moment, in one point, we are having a problem with accumulation of different compounds, of which many of them are persistent or hardly degradable. Nevertheless, if we talk about inorganic or organic material. Now, in certain moment, all of those hardly degradable compounds can be found in the groundwater. By which routes? Who is responsible for contamination of groundwater? We have natural ways how contaminants can reach the groundwaters. What are the natural sources? Majority of inorganic material, actually inorganic metals like iron, manganese, arsenic, chlorides, sulfates, even some radioactive material can be found in water because, you know, your soil through which water is filtered is rich in those materials. Also, we should not exclude organic matter that is present in the environment which decay, and in certain moment organic matter also can be found in the groundwater. But quite big importance when we talk about the contamination of the groundwater is actually a part that is part of human activities. So what humans do to environment and to the groundwaters? There are different sources from our everyday life through which we are releasing different contaminants in the environment, including groundwaters. So the most important issues are, for example, septic systems, fuel oil, household products, municipal landfills, waste landfills. For example, in Croatia we have quite big problem with landfills because we still didn't solve the issue of waste management. Some cities did, some cities didn't. I live in the capital of Croatia and we still have a huge problem. We are still struggling with separation of the waste and recyclation of the waste, and everything is going very, very slow and we do not satisfy the requirement, for example, of European Union and the laws that are present. So landfills represent a great, great issue. Also, some commercial activities like, I don't know, airports, boatyards, cemeteries, storage tanks represent big and important sources from which contamination of groundwater can occur. Industry, I think that we don't have to talk about industry. It's always some releasement of some waste, some byproducts from air, from soil, from water. And of course, agricultural activities, which are quite intensive now in springtime, where people are using different fertilizers that are of organic or inorganic origin, places where animals are buried or where animals are fed. All of those parts actually will have some impact on contamination of the environment and possibly contamination of the groundwater. Now, what is the negative side effects of environmental contaminants? We are talking about waters today. So what we have to bear in mind is that in water we can find different concentration of different compounds. actually not one compound, but mixture of compounds. And if we take into account that the water is something that we are exposed to through all our life, I mean, we have to drink water in different forms every day, at least 2 liters per day, right? If we are physically active, even more than 2 liters per day. It means that we are actually chronically exposed to all those chemicals that are really present in water. Now, independence of where we live and from where we take water, we will be exposed to certain types of chemicals. Yeah? For example, in Croatia they say that tap water is safe for use, and I use tap water for drinking and cooking and everything. But there are areas in the world, or there are countries, or even areas in Croatia, which have a problem with, for example, contamination of water with metals, with arsenic, for example. Eastern part of Croatia has a problem with arsenic. And people are not supposed to drink tap water. Okay, so if you drink for once that type of water that is contaminated with arsenic, probably you won't die. But if you are living in a place for 80 or 90 years and you are drinking the same water all your lifetime, you are actually chronically exposed to that chemical or mixture of chemicals that might have a fatal outcome. Now, let's try to explain each of these points. When we talk about the concentration, what do we know about concentration? What do we know about the doses? What classic toxicology do, it determines what is safe, right? So we take some experimental system and we are trying to determine, will we have some response? Response is something that we define. It might be toxic effect, cytotoxic effect, induction of free radicals, mutagenic effect, whatsoever. So nice thing is if we get this monotonic response. As we increase the concentration, we will increase some response, right? The problem starts when response is not monotonic. When you have a huge range of concentrations, doses, in which you get different responses. So there are the cases when very high and very low dose can provoke the same effect. And some dose in the middle does not have effect, or that effect is much lower. These two graphs of non-monotonic curves, they are typical for some endocrine disruptors, for example, right? Because endocrine disruptors, they are disrupting our hormonal system because they are active at very low concentrations. Hormones are active in picogram, nanogram concentrations. The same we can expect from some chemicals that can be found in the environment. So classic toxicology and classic approach where we will determine safe dose and say everything below that dose is safe is shaken by chemicals which for which we proved that they can do, you know, different if they could provoke different effect along range dose. Second issue are mixtures. I said that in water we don't have one compound. We have different compounds. So obviously we are exposed to the mixtures of the compounds. So what do we know about the mixtures? We don't know how those chemicals gonna interact one between each other. But overall effect of mixture can be that, I don't know, two or three compounds might have additive effect. What does it mean? It means that overall effect will be the sum of the effect of separate chemicals, okay? But also, in a mixture, we might expect something what we call synergism, synergistic reaction. What does it mean? It means when you put two chemicals together, the overall effect will be enhanced. It won't be a sum of activity of two chemicals, but something much stronger and much more prone to cause some effect. Third thing that we can expect when we talk about mixtures is potentiation. What it means? It means that Even though one chemical does not have some activity, when it's combined with another, it will potentiate this other chemical to provoke much stronger response than that chemical had before combining with the first one. And of course, in some cases, we can have antagonistic effect. If we mix two compounds, the overall effect can be decreased. Now, what scenario will be, it's quite unpredictable, especially when we talk about complex mixture from the environment. I mean, you can do the testing with two or three chemicals, but you must be aware that our waters that we drink are composed of much more compounds than two or three, right? And of course, some chemical interaction can happen between those chemicals that are present in a mixture. So two compounds, they can have the same target in an organism. Chemical mode can occur when a chemical interaction between two compounds affects the toxicity of one of the chemical. One chemical can change metabolism or distribution or elimination of the other. So again, we will be in a pretty dark zone. We won't be able to predict what effect actually of certain chemical will be. And also, when we talk about the mixture of compounds, we can expect that two compounds will have affinity for the same receptor. So we will have competition between different chemicals. Okay? So there are quite a few issues that we don't know, actually. And the third point that we have mentioned there was the chronic exposure, right? When we are exposed to high concentration of some chemical, we probably will experience some toxic effect. But if we are exposed to low concentration of anything, probably we won't have symptoms of some negative side effect. The problem occurs when we are chronically exposed to those low concentrations during our life. And that's something what we call everyday exposure, environmental exposure. And that's something what is really a concern of modern toxicology. What low doses of different compounds do to our body during our lifetime. If we talk about drinking water, then we really have to be aware that we are chronically exposed to low concentrations of different elements, different compounds, which might interact in different way, and what would be the consequences, it's very hard to know. Okay? So how people determine what is safe and what is not safe? How people determine which water should be used for drinking, which water should not be used for drinking? If you take a bottle of water, you will have written the results of chemical analysis, actually physical and chemical analysis. You will get information about concentrations of all important elements inside. You will know data about conductivity of those waters and so on and so on. Also, waters are checked for the presence of some contaminants. And if there are some contaminants there, that water probably won't be bottled. If we talk about tap water, again, we are having different services in countries which check the quality of the water. For example, in Croatia, water is chlorinated. Okay, so microbiological safety is ensured by chlorination. So if we have a lot of rain in some period of time, you will be able to smell chlorine in that water. Also, when we have very dry periods, they put more chlorine inside to ensure that microorganisms don't start to rise. And sometimes in that cases, they recommend that water not should be drinking, that water should not be drinking. So obviously there are some services that are running chemical and physical analysis of the water in order to ensure that water that we eat or drink is safe for use. But in last period, there is more and more demand that besides physical and chemical analysis, biological testing of the waters should be run. What means biological testing? It does not mean identification of microorganisms, because it is normally done. But to use some biological tests, some living organisms, which probably are slightly genetically modified, in order to give you the information what will be the effect of these waters on those organisms, on living organisms. Now, what systems are usually used? I don't know how many of those organisms are you familiar with. Are you familiar with any of them? You heard for some of them. So different systems are developed to catch different effects. For example, when we talk about Salmonella typhimurium, have you heard for Ames assay? I think you did. It's a very well-known test. So those strains are slightly, it's not wild Salmonella typhimurium that you can find in the environment. It is genetically modified slightly. These strains are constructed in order to detect gene mutation. So point mutations in meaning of frameshift mutations and base substitution mutations. But also you can check cytotoxicity of your chemical, because if the number of bacteria drop, you will obviously conclude that chemical that you are testing on this system is toxic for the bacteria. Human lymphocytes are very nice test system, because lymphocytes you can get from the humans simply by taking a blood from a healthy, non-smoking young person. And in lymphocytes you can determine oxidative damage, you can determine chromosomal mutations. With lymphocytes, it's this very nice thing that you can take the whole blood, you can see it in complete media, you can treat your lymphocytes out of the body for several hours or a day or two, and then you can actually prepare your slides or whatsoever to measure those damages. So you have undamaged cells, primary cells, and you can get information about oxidative effect and about damaging chromosomal material. Alternative to lymphocytes are human cell lines. The major obstacle of human cell lines is the fact that they are genetically changed. They are formed from cancerous tissue and they are grown in vitro. So even if you try to establish cell line from normal cells, you will kill yourself to do that, because normal cells, they do not divide. If we talk about, I don't know, cells which has not mutation inside. If you force normal cell to start to grow in vitro conditions, that means that you will stimulate proliferation. If you stimulate proliferation, that means that you have disturbed cell cycle. So again, you got some mutated cells. Okay, but human cell lines are still widely used, because you can always do control. You can have non-treated cells, and you can compare the results that you got on treated cells, and you can really say that difference between treated cells and control is a consequence of influence of some chemical. So on human cell lines, you can also determine oxidative damage, you can determine chromosomal mutations, cytotoxicity. But also, today people are making different constructs in which you can determine some epigenetics changes, but also endocrine disruptors. They just recombinate human cells. They introduce some plasmids, which are, for example, activated if in the environment you have chemicals which might and which behave like endocrine disruptors. Also, there are some plant tests like Allium cepa, on which you can follow the change of mitotic index, where you actually grow ordinary onion and you check the cells of the root, right? And you control how much your mitotic index will be changed in comparison to the control. For example, in Tarascantia, you can run a micronucleus. So There are different systems which will make your puzzle to put together. Because if you get, I don't know, positive results on Salmonella, if you get positive results on lymphocytes, you will probably be quite sure that your chemical causes point mutations and chromosomal mutations, and that chemical really is dangerous. Okay, if you get positive results on Allium cepa and negative on Salmonella difformium, you will probably be able to say that your chemical does not cause point mutations, but there is something that stimulates cell proliferation. Okay, so from all of those data, you can construct a story. You can tell and predict what is the nature of the chemical or mixture of chemicals to provoke some event in living cells and living organisms. So let's see how we can imply some of those tests in physical and chemical analysis of devoters. At the beginning of the lecture, I have mentioned that we will discuss two examples. So, first example will be actually testing of genotoxicity of waters which origin from metal industry and of waters that we found in surrounding area. When we talk about some industry, it is expected that the waters in the industry will be okay, contaminated, right? That they will have some metals and some compounds that might provoke some negative effect. But the problem is surrounding area. We don't want to find contaminants in the surrounding area. Why? Because waters from the surrounding area might form groundwaters, and those groundwaters might be, well, used for drinking or for any other purpose or for flooding some area where you grow your plants. So that's something what we don't want to happen. That's the reason why we have to purify the waters before we release them to the environment. So what waters were sampled and what waters were tested? We had one sample that was sampled upstream and downstream from the factory, and three samples that were sampled in the factory at a different location. So chemical analysis revealed some increased parameters in according to the legal values that can be found in the water. So we can see that waters that are in that are collected in the industry had elevated level of ammonia. They have elevated phenols, okay? There was some increased level of lead in this sample 42. And there were some elevated values of zinc and cadmium in sample 42. 43 and 45 were not that much contaminated. And water that was collected downstream from the factory, we can see that there are some parameters which should ring a bell. Those waters are actually something what is collected after the factory, what is bad. Now, what did we get on some of those tests? Don't be bothered with the data that are presented on these two slides. This first graph represents actually the induction of frameshift mutation when metabolic activator was added. Do we know what metabolic activator is? It's a liver homogenite. And the purpose of liver homogenite, so you mix bacteria, you mix your chemical that you are testing, and you mix this liver homogenite in order to provoke metabolism of some chemicals which are not mutagenic by themselves, but will be turned to some electrophilic compounds after metabolism. So this liver homogenate actually simulates events in the liver that will happen in the liver of the mammals and humans. So what we got here is that samples, except the sample that was collected upstream from the factory, actually induced mutagenic effect. This QM is actually information about the ratio between inducted cells and cells that were grown on negative control. So if this number, if this QM is around 1, it means that chemical does not have mutagenic effect. But if this ratio rises in favor of induced mutated bacteria, it means that mutations occur. So this sample that was taken upstream from the factory, only the lowest concentration provoke a quite high quotient of mutations. But other samples had, in all concentration range, increased quotient of mutations. When we did the same thing without adding metabolic activator, when we wanted to see if chemicals by themselves in the water provoke mutation, the response was a little bit more silenced. There are some samples, including sample one that was collected upstream from the factory, which gave us the information that we actually really have some mutagenic compounds inside. But other samples did not provoke that higher response. This is actually a problem because this effect does not have nothing to do with the factory. So that means that we have sources of contamination from somewhere else, not from the factory. But what is interesting to mention here is that, for example, those positive results that we got for 42, 43, 44th and 45th samples is that all of them had increased polyphenols, which might be responsible for the positive effect when metabolic activator was added. Okay. We have also tested cytotoxic effect on human cell lines. And we tested cytotoxicity on two cell lines. This cell line origins from larynx, and these are cervix cell lines. But we can see that all of those samples were actually quite toxic when they were diluted for 50%. And the cytotoxic effect increases as we increase the concentration. Nevertheless, which cell line was applied? And also the same effect we've got when cells were left for 24 hours to recover after the treatment. So obviously, toxic effect was initiated in a moment when we added those samples, and damage was not repaired during the period of recovery. Also, here we have results of DNA damage, and we can see that actually all samples caused DNA damage. So, what is expected to happen according to the position and site of water collection is that the samples from the factory and downstream from the factory that they will have some positive effect. That's something what we expect. But the problem was with water that was collected upstream from the factory, where we saw that we have quite high genotoxic response on different level, on human cell lines, on Salmonella. And if we compare it with maximal allowable values that might be in those waters, we might conclude that the parameters were below the majority of, for the majority of the elements below this value, but this mixture caused a mutagenic effect. The other problem is that in this water that was collected upstream from the factory is that source of contamination somewhere else. So we cannot point at factory only, we have to search for other contaminants. At that site there are quite a lot of agricultural activities, so origin can be from who knows where, pesticides or fertilizers or whatsoever. The other example is the example of experiments that we have run in order to prove is one communal waste landfill safe for use. I said that in Croatia we have a problem with landfills, but this is the example of the city that has solved this issue. They really collect separated waste on this site from where we took samples of waters. Only non-hazardous waste is collected, and it's my cell phone, sorry. All water that is formed like leachate is collected and it is transferred to purifier. And waters that are released from this landfill are purified. Okay, so what we wanted to do is to check does this landfill really functions? Is it environmentally safe? Now, this is a fragment of that landfill and purifier. Here is the water that was formed on the landfill and which is collected in this big pool. And this water is sent to a purifier. And after that, it is released into the environment. This this city is placed nearby Zagreb, okay? So Zagreb has a problem, this city does not have a problem. So with the landfill and with waste. So what have we done? We have collected several samples. We collect samples upstream from the site of purification, downstream from the site of purification, and at the site of purification. But also those waters P1, P2, and P3, those are groundwaters. Okay, that's something what we pick from some distance in soil. But also we pick leachate. That's that ugly black water here before purification. It's number four. And we did chemical determination of chemical composition. We determine potential genotoxic effect. And according to all of those data, we have estimated the potential environmental hazard. So in order to do that, again, we use different Salmonella diphimurium strains, the one which serves for detection of frameshift mutation and the other that serves for base substitution mutations. We have used laryngeal cell line, by which we determined cytotoxicity, reactive oxygen species formation, damaging of lipids, and induction of DNA damage. We investigated different range of concentrations, okay? This one-time concentration means the concentration which is present in the groundwater or in that big pool. When we concentrate the water, we were able to make higher concentrations. Okay, so here are the results of chemical analysis. And the good news is that in groundwaters we didn't detect any compound that is too high, and the level of metals were not detectable or were at that bottom level. The same goes for groundwater and for the leachate. What we detected in the leachate is that electroconductivity was quite low in comparison to the groundwaters. Chemical oxygen depletion and biological oxygen depletion was very high. Suspended matter also was quite high. And some parameters like nitrogen or phosphorus or some other cations and anions were quite high. The good thing is that there was no detectable metals, heavy metals, or if they were detectable, their levels were quite low. Also, I forgot to mention that we collected waters in autumn and in spring to see if temperature plays a role and the quantity of rain. So, in further slides, only results of leachates are presented because groundwaters gave negative results, so I didn't put it on slides. So what we can see is that 50% that we measured 50% of dead cells with spring waters at concentration 7.92 and with autumn waters at 3.93 times the concentrated water. So that means that actually 50% we reach at concentrations which are higher than water is really present in that big pool. Now, when we talk about reactive oxygen species, here we compare autumn and spring, and we can see that as we rise the concentration, the reactive oxygen species induction rises. Here in this spring water, these values are falling down, but you must bear in your mind that we don't have cells. Okay, and reactive oxygen species you can measure only in cells which have a functional membrane, because activation of the compound that enters to the cell happens as it passes through the membrane. So if you don't have membrane integrity, you won't have activated reagent, and you will get the idea that this thing behaves like antioxidant. So it sounds good. Okay. When we have measured lipid peroxidation, which is in majority of the cases caused by free radicals. Some activated compounds can cause it also, but radicals are responsible for it. You can see that we have some dose response, especially for these spring waters. And there is the increase in lipid peroxidation for other waters that were collected in the autumn. But what we can conclude from here is that obviously we have differences among seasons because of the quantity of the rain, because of the temperature, okay? So those factors might play an important role. Because as the temperature is higher, more degradable products are produced. Finally, we have tried to determine point mutations and DNA breakage, so we try to determine the mutation effects. So we come to the conclusion that those waters didn't cause point mutations, and also the parameters of tail length and tail intensity in some cases were slightly increased in comparison to the negative control, but none of them were statistically significant. So chemical composition of and metal composition of compounds that were present in these samples, groundwaters and leachates, was below level of detection. Leachate was rich on suspended matter, nitrogen, phosphorus. They have high levels of COD and BOD. And those parameters indicate that we have high level of organic matter. So that's the problem, you know, when you have organic matter, you can have everything in your inert material, but also some active compound, which might do quite a big problem in a cell. So genotoxic potential was observed in leachate, as it was expected. But what was good is that the groundwater near the filter and beneath the filter did not show any genotoxic potential. So we can actually conclude based on all of those results that purification process that is conducted at the landfill is effective, and there is no release of different compounds in the environment. So we have proved it by chemical analysis, but also with application of test system. But when we talk about the leachate, even though the parameters of the leachate were not so dramatic, the only dramatic part is this organic matter. We proved that actually that organic matter has different compounds which might do significant damage of cells. So at the end of this story, we might conclude that physicochemical analysis definitely give us very important information about presence of some harmful chemicals that can be found in the groundwaters. But additional tests, which include some living organisms or some models will make us able to overcome the lack of information about influence of mixtures of compounds on cellular macromolecules and on cells and on tissues and on organisms. And also we can overcome this problem of non-monotonicity of the curves. So introducing of a battery of biological tests, which are actually not expensive, which are quite simple and which gives you the information about the genotoxic potential of different compounds, maybe in some perspective should be defined and maybe should be standardized and maybe introduced in some testing in the future. For now, physical and chemical analysis are prescribed by the law, but those tests actually prove that maybe things should be a little bit spread for some additional tests. Okay, so that's all I think what I wanted to tell you about. Now I would like if we can start the discussion. Can
thank you very much, Xenia. Bueno, ahora se abre un turno de preguntas. Podéis levantar la mano si queréis y vamos registrando las intervenciones que vayáis haciendo. Y bueno, pues Xenia os tratará de contestar a todo aquello que queráis. Bueno, tomamos la palabra Suilén.
Thank you for your presentation. I have a question. Is there any legislation that they takes into account the evaluation of the persistent organic pollutants?
Is there any legislation that takes about organic persistent organic? Actually not, because they are not measuring persistent pollutants like as such. They are measuring organic matter. So they say what level of organic matter you can have, but they are not, you know, detecting compound by compound, for example. So that's the problem, because no one is measuring certain pesticide, certain residue. They do that in some certain cases when you request some company to do that for you. But waters that are, you know, that serves for supplying of households and so on, they don't do that. They determine more general compounds, a group of compounds actually, not one by one. Probably it would be, I don't know, too expensive or too time consuming, because you have to supply people every day with water. So if you would do, you know, 300 compounds of organic origin every day, you would not be able to do that as such. So there is a problem with that.
Okay, thank you.
No. Yes. Yeah. Please.
What's the method, the techniques for measuring the release of oxidative stress in lymphocytes or blood cells?
Okay, so there are different approaches. You can measure free radicals, reactive oxygen species that are produced. There are different reagents that you can really use. I use one compound, which name is dichlorfluorocein diacetate. So this molecule is stable as such, but when it passes through the membrane, it first loses this acetate group, and once when it enters into the cell, Then it is heated by free radicals, and then you get a fluorescent response. And then you measure actually the fluorescence. So, yeah, a majority of techniques that measure free radicals are based on fluorescence response. Of course, cells that are not treated, they also have certain level of free radicals inside.
Because it should be very sensitive.
It is. But prerequisite is that your cell is really alive, if you have stable membrane. Because if you don't lose this acetate group, and you won't lose them if you don't have active transport and activity of certain enzymes which are present in the membrane, you will get negative results. And then you can come to the wrong conclusion that your chemical does not provoke free radicals or that it decreases. So you always have to compare it with cytotoxicity assay. Actually, you have to measure the stability of the membrane to be able to comment this assays of free radicals. The other method is that you measure not only free radicals, because you know free radicals sometimes can be inhibited, they can bound for some compartment in the cell, so maybe you won't be able to measure it. A little bit higher level is to measure DNA damage, or lipid damage, or protein damage. Here you will get a consequence of free radical production on a level of cellular macromolecules. So you will be able to combine. I mean, you have to, it's really a puzzle. From each of these tests, you get one information. And then you have to put those information one beside.
Together, yeah.
Yeah, sometimes it's complicated. Sometimes you get opposite things. Sometimes you don't know how to comment some things. But that's the purpose of all that. Okay, thank you. Yes, please.
Hi. Thank you for the talk.
You're welcome.
That's so awesome.
Thank you.
I have a question. It's like, you mentioned that the organic compounds were the mixture that's compound of the responsible for the genotoxic, the effects, the side effects that we could observe. So, do you think that the combination of metal, inorganic metal, could produce these effects too?
It's hard to say. It might or it might not, because you don't know what will be. The only thing how you can get the answer on this question is to combine, you know, metals in different ratios and in different types, and to measure it, and then try to predict what is responsible. You can do that also organic matter plus different metals, and see what you will get. The problem is here, we have, you know, term organic matter, what means everything, everything that is of organic origin is organic matter. And as you said, and as you noticed, we have metals. They are at low concentrations, but they are there. And now, how they combine and what they do, it's really impossible to say. You only can use the table of chemical analysis. You can see what, you know, is increased. And maybe you can try to connect the biological effect with that concentration. But there is the possibility that metals can make louder sound, make louder response, or it may decrease the certain effect. All scenarios are possible. That's the reason, you know, gray field where you cannot give a clear answer without additional experiments.
In Mesoamerican, we have problems. Mm-hmm. We have an investigation the last year, so we could prove that there is a specific combination of metals. It's not the dose of metal, it's the combination that could predict in a specific sums the probability to develop kidney disease. Mm-hmm. So that is the reason of my answer, because I don't know, the limit normal, considered normal of the Union European or about the Organization of Health and International, so was normal. But the combination of metal was different in different zones, so that explains the presence of kidney disease.
Yeah.
So there is no other causes in that zone.
Yeah.
So then, okay, thank
yeah.
you.
When you mention this concentration and what is normal and what is not normal, it is also, you know, discussable. We can discuss about it. For example, I will just mention, because it is I read quite a lot about it, aflatoxin. We all know what is aflatoxin, a contaminant that is produced by Aspergillus flavus. So it is hepatotoxic, it is a carcinogenic compound, and it is bioaccumulated in the liver. So, for example, according to the European law, permitted level is 10 times lower than it is in, for example, Canada, America, Australia, because there's no proof that 10 times higher concentrations are more toxic than 10 times lower concentration. So, you know, regulatives are also based on different investigations and conclusions of group of the people who decided to conclude something. And you can really have variations from countries to from country to country. So no one says that low concentration of metal should be considered normal. For example, cadmium is carcinogenic. I think that one molecule of carcinogenic compound can cause some damage in itself. So is it enough to initiate carcinogenicity? Theoretically, yes, but you know, it's really, I think that people are doing their best to find some optimal solution, because you cannot avoid chemicals, they are here. But do we have a right or not? It's, I think that those things are very alive and they're changing periodically, and people are coming out with some new conclusions, and that's very vivid thing, so.
This slide, this talk, it could be very expensive for our minds, because it's not only the presence of some specific compound. So we have an additive effect, we have an expand mind about the mm-hmm. mixture mm-hmm. of the different compounds. So mm-hmm. I think that this presentation was very important for that.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Or even the effect of the potentiation, you say.
Is it the effect of it?
Potentiation.
Oh yeah.
You have no toxicity, but when you have this molecule, you have some toxicity.
So that's
and
what.
So the levels are not isolated for each.
So all of those are great problems. So.
I wanted to tell that.
Yes.
Okay.
No, you are the only one.
Thank you very much. Xenia, it's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you.
As a scientist and as a person, well. And I wonder whether there are any epidemiological studies around in Croatia, for instance, to check if these things have effect on the
not really
environmental health of the population.
Yeah, you mean around
from drinking water? Or
No. We are, for example, we are struggling with. I said we are struggling with arsenic in eastern Croatia, and they are saying that that water is safe for drink. But there are quite a lot of people that are suffering from diseases of kidneys. And you know, regulative bodies, they don't want to say that it is a consequence of arsenic, because it is below that level. It is measurable, but it is below the level, you know. But people are drinking bottled water. They don't use tap water anymore. But we have really increased number of people who are suffering from different diseases that might be caused by low levels of arsenic if you are chronically exposed to them. But you know, that's a problem. You drink water, you have no effect. After 20 years, you have a problem. And it's very hard to prove that it was caused by that water. Because some people who are maybe born in that village and went to live in Zagreb didn't develop this disease. And then they say, okay, you see, this guy's healthy, so what do you want? It happens. So we are still not doing that epidemiological studies concerning some environmental contaminations. Because generally speaking, Croatia is considered to be quite non-contaminated area. But there are billion examples. For example, around Zagreb there was factories in the previous times. And now as Zagreb has started to spread, people have started to build buildings on the area where industry was. And you have some symptomatic things that, I don't know, a lot of kids suffer from asthma, some people develop some cancers, and you know, you see that it is because of the position where those people live, but you cannot prove it, because, you know, how can it happen that kids from certain area, we have increased number of kids that have asthma, that suffer from asthma. But no one is doing that epidemiological study as such. Probably it will come with the time, but
yeah,
at this moment, no. And they like to say nothing is happening, everything is cool. So
something is happening, I don't know, because in Spain, just I think recently, they started to do those kind of studies. And recently I read that there is a correlation of certain cancers,
yeah,
kidney, skin, brain, with the amount of arsenic in the area,
yeah,
and the amount of arsenic concentration in the soils, for instance,
yeah,
which does not mean contamination, this is pollution necessarily, it could be geochemically, but there are correlations,
yeah,
and also correlations of death from cancer for population living just 5 kilometers away from or less from some industry complexes. And I mean, they are just correlations, they are not cause and effect relationships, but that tells you something, because we are talking about 45 million people in the case of Spain.
Yeah.
So there are lots of data showing that you have to take care about that, okay.
We are a much smaller population, there are some maybe 4 million people in Croatia. We are prone to migrate, you know, so it's very hard to... We are not like people who are connected to the place where they were born and then they live their whole life.
Yeah.
They migrate in Croatia and now outside of Croatia, so it's very hard to run some serious study, you know. And there's no such intention. People are doing some studies, I mean, people are doing some PhD studies, blah, blah, but it's not something official that will not be something that will come out, like, it will be written that PhD thesis and that's it. Yeah.
Is there any study about the seawater near the industries or...
Seawater in nearby industry?
Because of concentration of heavy metals in fish.
There are studies, people were doing analysis of the water, but now these days we don't really have any industry on Adriatic Sea. In previous time we had a great problem with copper and heavy metal industry in one place. But I think that they didn't catch fish in that area because it was really, really contaminated. And we have asbestos industry, which was also shut down. Today, the major problem are harbors, because in Adriatic Sea, big ships with ballast water comes. And we have problem with, for example, 2 years ago, fish was found in Adriatic Sea, which is impossible to be born in Adriatic. There's no... So obviously from ballast water that fish came to the Adriatic. We have problem with algae that starts to grow and kill natural flora. But there's no heavy industry anymore. But in previous time, yeah. And the problem with Adriatic, if you compare it with Mediterranean or oceans, is that it's quite closed. You know, there's no exchange of water. So I know that the dilution is not something what the solution, but in this case it would be a little bit better that we dilute it a little bit. But there's no such effect also. So quite. Things are quite complicated when we talk about Adriatic. And yes, the fish might be quite contaminated with heavy metals. Yeah. You're welcome.
Okay, so thank you very much, Senia, for your talk. It has been a pleasure to listen about your results and
thank you.
Your conclusions and everything. And
Y bueno, pues muchas gracias a todos y todas por asistir a este seminario. Que nadie se olvide de firmar las correspondientes hojas. Y bueno, pues hasta la próxima, que nos veamos aquí en los seminarios.